Hello and welcome to our service for Sunday the 17th of July 2022. I'm glad you're with us today. I pray well, God will bless you mightily during the course of this service. I tell you what, the summer is hotting up here, certainly in England at the moment. The weather forecasters are predicting we might even have temperatures as high as 40 degrees, which is record-breaking for this country. Mercifully, down here in Eastleigh, we're not far from the south coast, so we get a lovely breeze blowing up from the channel, from the Solent, and to cooling us down more than some parts of the country get. It's a wonderful thing. But either way, about the weather, about whatever circumstances there are, we are in the hands of God and we are following our Lord Jesus. As Hebrews 12:2 tells us, we are fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down on the right hand of the throne of God. He is our faithful one. The words of the song are that your love is the anchor. My hope is in you. My hope is in you. Our hope is in you alone. Let's sing this together. Let's worship the Lord. Let's start our time just asking God and confirming him in our hearts as our faithful God.
You're my rock of peace.
Our hope is in you alone. And so, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this honour of being able to come into your presence, to dwell where you are. In church or wherever we're watching the video, we just know that you are with us. And I pray, Lord God, that as this service unfolds, your presence will be more keenly felt than perhaps we thought it would, so that you can change our lives and do new and great things in us. In Jesus' name, amen. Now we're going to sing again. This is a wonderful hymn, Dear Lord and Father of Mankind. The last verse, talking about heat. Breathe through the heats of our desire, thy coolness and thy balm. Let sense be dumb, let flesh retire. Speak through the earthquake, wind and fire. O still, small voice of calm. O still, small voice of calm.
We hold the sea by
Isn't that wonderful? A fantastic hymn. And I hope you joined in with that too. Now we're going to come to our reading. And there's really two parts to this today, because the first couple of verses I want to read you are actually part of the reading that we probably should have done last week when we were talking about the church at Thessalonica. Our message today very much follows on from that. And so this first part gives you context as to why Paul was in Berea, where we are concentrating on today. This is Acts 17, verses 5 and 6. But other Jews were jealous of Paul's ministry in Thessalonica, so they rounded up some bad characters from the marketplace, formed a mob, and started a riot in the city. They rushed to Jason's house in search of Paul and Silas in order to bring them out to the crowd. But they did not find them. Now moving on to our reading proper, so to speak, this is Acts 17 still, this is verses 10 to 15. As soon as it was night, the believers sent Paul and Silas away to Berea. On arriving there, they went to the Jewish synagogue. Now the Berean Jews were of more noble character than those in Thessalonica, because they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. As a result, many of them believed, as did also a number of prominent Greek women and many Greek men. But when the Jews in Thessalonica learned that Paul was preaching the word of God in Berea, some of them went there too, agitating the crowds and stirring them up. The believers immediately sent Paul to the coast, but Silas and Timothy stayed at Berea. Those who escorted Paul brought him to Athens and then left with instructions for Silas and Timothy to join him as soon as possible. Let's sing again.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Thank you, God. Next verse. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to hear, and grace my fears. How precious in that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy breaks, unending love. Amazing. The Lord has promised good to me. His word of hope secures. He will my shield and portion be. As long as I endure, my chains. earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine. You are forever mine. Come on, sing that. You are forever mine. One more time. You are forever mine.
That's a beautiful song. We enjoy that very much here at Emmanuel, and I pray that you'll enjoy it singing that today as well. Lovely. Now, as we come to the message from the Word of God, as I said a moment ago, this very much follows on the tales of the episode in Paul's second missionary journey that we looked at last week when he found himself in Thessalonica. Having got into some hot water there that we read about a moment ago, preaching the gospel, he then moved about 50 kilometers southwest to Berea. Berea, as a town, still exists. It's now in Greece and it's called Berea. It was a small Macedonian city, not a great commercial center like Thessalonica, but a prosperous center nonetheless for farmers and artists and stone cutters. It was a bit of an off the beaten track kind of place. It was at the foot of Mount Berimus, from which it took its name. Whilst Thessalonica was a city of victories, having been named after a victory, Berea can therefore be seen as a city of mountains, as it has mountains on about three of its sides. I want to take three of those mountains: repetition, reception, and rejection. The mountain of repetition comes first, and it's a pretty obvious one really. Paul again went straight to the synagogue, as he had done at Philippi, although he couldn't find one, so he went to the riverside, as he had done at Thessalonica, where he preached the gospel, not being daunted or discouraged by the fact that he had met with such opposition there amongst the Thessalonican Jews. Paul was passionate about his mission. He was passionate about preaching the gospel, and he never shied away from doing so, even when persecution came his way. He kept repeating the same thing again, talking about the gospel. He just moved camp. He went somewhere else and started again. Jesus often did that too, and it's worth holding that in mind, certainly if you're in a ministry position, but also maybe in a career, or maybe in your personal life. Maybe there are times when you have to move somewhere else, do something different in order to achieve the goal that you know is right for you. That is not running away. That is, as I said last week, not wasting time in some of life's cul-de-sacs. You may well be familiar with the notion that if you keep on doing the same things, you will keep on getting the same results. And that is certainly true. To get better outcomes, we need to do better things. Now, the Apostle Paul was not really in that boat, because he was already doing good things and getting great results. People were becoming saved. There were churches planted through his ministry. He just learned the wisdom of moving somewhere else when trouble came calling, to carry on that good work and not wasting his time in cul-de-sacs. Now, I wonder if you've mentioned how Hebrews 12 verse 1 tells us to throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily tangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. You see, a lot of the time, if we're to be honest, we find it easier to quit the race marked out for us, our ministry, or whatever that race is, than throwing off the things that inhibit us from running that race well. Now, I could be tempted to leave an illustration or two about that, but actually I'm going to ask you to mull that over in your own minds, to consider what you need to do, what you need to lose, what habit you need to give up, what sin you need to avoid, what security blanket you need to let go of in order to move on in the race that God has marked out for you personally. But I think the same thing applies in church life too. As a church here at Emmanuel, we have a clearly defined mission. We have an articles of faith that guide us in that mission. But we don't have a rule book telling us how to do that mission, and yet sometimes we follow rules. There are times, I would argue, when we need to leave those rules behind, when we need to cast off the things that hinder, if indeed they do hinder us, and run the race that God has marked out for us by the guidance of the Holy Spirit, changing what needs to be changed, not repeating the same old things that have not worked before. That's a challenge for me as a church leader, to find what that will of God is, so we can hold on to that race of ours as a fellowship. I know God has got great things in store for us, and we will see the fruition of that. Absolutely. And then, of course, there is the mountain of reception. One of the problems of preaching is that it's always nice to know how the message is being received. Now, when you've got a congregation in front of you, you can often tell that. You can look at people's faces. You can see whether they're bored. You can see whether they're engaged. You can see whether they smile. You can see whether they roll their eyes back. But doing what I'm doing at the moment, just speaking to a camera, really doesn't give me any feedback at all. I like to see who I'm speaking to get some instant feedback from the faces of the listeners. Now, you can see from the picture here the scene that I see when I'm recording these messages, and I would much prefer this church to be full of people while I'm talking. I absolutely would. In this format, I don't even know who is watching the videos, never mind what they're thinking. Mind you, I'm glad you are watching the videos, and I hope that you will be sharing these with other people too. It would be really great. In Berea, as in Thessalonica, Paul had a good reception, and he felt that good reception. He could feel the way that they responded to the word of God. In quantitative terms, in Acts 17:12, as a result, many of them believed, as did also a number of prominent Greek women and many Greek men. Now, I don't know how many was. I don't know how many people there were in the first place, but many suggests that it was a good result. The Greek word for many is polis, and it's used elsewhere in the Bible to describe a large number or great crowds. That's Jews, Greek men, and prominent women all coming together in response to the word of God. Beautiful, absolutely lovely. Now, we often think a mark of the success of a church or a mission is in quantitative terms. Numbers. How big is your church? Is something which I find crops up in way too many conversations to make me comfortable with it. It's not bad in itself. It is something of a barometer of the way that a church is functioning, but it isn't the be-all and end-all. You can look through the New Testament and you can see the way that various churches functioned, from the letters written to them, Ephesus, Philippi, Thessalonica, we mentioned, Colossae. But you will not find in any of them, or even all the way through the book of Acts, you will not find the numbers of people in those churches mentioned at all. I have to tell you that I believe that God is just actually no more interested in the quality of the work than in the numbers involved in it. That might sound a bit odd, but I believe that is true. How effective the work is should be measured by the effect that it has on people's lives. You can look into Revelation chapter 2 and chapter 3, and you will find seven churches mentioned there. Their size is not talked about at all. What is discussed are their strengths and weaknesses. Because Thessalonica was more populous than Berea, it isn't unreasonable to assume that the church was more populous too, but there is another side to it, and it comes in Acts 17:11. The Berean Jews were more noble character than those in Thessalonica, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. They examined the words of Paul the Apostle. Can you believe that? And he didn't get offended by it. That is wonderful. That is absolutely brilliant. I don't think this was a put down of the Thessalonians. I think it was a statement of the quality of the receptions that the Bereans gave Paul's ministry. They had open minds. They were willing to learn. They were willing to evaluate, and they were willing to practice. The word noble was usually reserved for those of noble birth. But this is spiritual nobility. It is equated with listening to and retaining the word of God. You may remember that Jesus spoke a parable of the sower. And in Luke 8:15 we find this: but the seed on good soil stands for those with a noble and good heart, who hear the word, retain it, and by persevering produce a crop. Lovely. Nobility is equated with great eagerness, or all eagerness if you prefer, to receive the message. Nobility is the opposite of gullibility. Now, we need to not be gullible when we listen to the word of God, because there are many false teachers around. There are many people espousing this theory and that theory. We need to be able to test those against the actual word of God. We need, like the Bereans, to be able to say, just a minute, what is it the word of God says? And teach ourselves, if not from our churches, whether things are right or whether they are not. They were not reading the New Testament. That was being written around them while they lived their lives. They were reading the prophets. They were reading the Torah. And maybe the Talmud, the sort of commentary on the Torah. From those books, Paul had preached that Jesus was the Messiah. And it squared up with what they read in those books. They examined the scriptures, and they did it daily. Examined there is a legal term to get to the truth. And these Bereans did just that. Now, you know that during the course of these videos, I put some scriptures up and fill the entire screen. I put some scriptures up that fill half the screen. I put some references alone at the side there. I do all of that to give you the opportunity to examine those scriptures for yourself and to find out if what I'm saying really is what the Bible is saying. Because if it isn't, don't listen to me. Let me say that with all honesty. Good preaching is always going to be Bible-based. I would go too far as to say if somebody stands in a pulpit anywhere and doesn't mention the scriptures at all, they're probably not preaching at all either. Now, there's nothing wrong with a good homily, but preaching is Bible-based, always. I encourage you to receive it, to check it, to discuss it, to challenge it if you feel that is the right thing to do. I would welcome that. As the psalmist David put it in Psalm 119, verses 105 to 106, your word is a lamp for my feet and a light for my path. I have taken an oath and confirmed it that I will follow your righteous laws. That's a nobility in studying the scriptures, to take an oath and confirm it, that we will follow God's righteous laws. A noble believer eagerly, but not gullibly, embraces the word of God with openness. To be a noble believer, we have to engage some critical thinking. We have to test what is being said against the truths that we find in the scripture. Now, lastly, I want to talk about the mountain of rejection. There is no record of the Jews and their leaders in Berea having a problem with Paul's preaching. What happened was that rent-a-mob, if you like, came from Thessalonica. They turned up with the express task of agitating trouble for Paul and his team. Now, presumably these were either the same as or associates of the Jews who stirred up problems in Thessalonica, accusing Paul of treason against Caesar. Wasn't the first time. The Jews from Antioch and Iconium did the same thing at Lystra, where they stoned Paul in Acts 14, verse 19. There again, he simply went somewhere else and carried on preaching. Of course, they did that to Jesus too, trying him on trumped up charges that first Easter. There is nothing new in persecution. There is nothing new in rejection. But I tell you something, it gets to you. You may have noticed this in your own lives, whether it's in a relationship or a job or in friendship circles or in whichever way. Rejection is a horrible, horrible thing. It gets to you. You feel it personally and it begins to undermine you. Rejection, particularly repeated rejection, can be a huge mountain for any of us to climb. Again, that spans every avenue of our lives. If only we could just brush these things off and move on, as some people casually advise us to do. But you know that that's just not possible. It's not that simple. So, I want to take some advice on this from what happened with the Apostle Paul. This is really good. Acts 17, 14 to 15. The believers immediately sent Paul to the coast, but Silas and Timothy stayed at Berea. Those who escorted Paul brought him to Athens. Paul was not alone, and he was not deserted. It is always safer to climb mountains in company, and we are called to look out for each other and look after each other. I love it that there were believers who sent Paul, and there were believers who escorted him, who went with him. That's a strength of fellowship that each Christian should be a part of and each church should facilitate. The mountain of rejection, as well as the mountain of doubt, the mountain of healing, or whatever the mountain might be before you, is better faced with brothers and sisters in Christ who will either send you in faith or go with you in faith, if they possibly can. Some people, all they can do is pray for you, because they haven't got the facility, the ability, in one way or another, to walk with you. But there are others who can walk with you. Together, we make up the ministry of what the church should be doing. It means, of course, we must also be willing to be those who do the sending, who do the praying, and willing to be those who do the escorting, who do the going with. We can't all do everything, but we can all do something to make our lives in the church fellowship better for every one of us. That's why we do church. That's why we never minimize the importance of church. There was another thing though. It's good to know that there was somebody left behind in Berea to take up the vision. Silas and Timothy stayed there because it wasn't Paul's church. It was God's, and they could carry on the work that he started. It wasn't Paul's vision. It was God's vision. And Silas and Timothy could stay behind and fulfill that vision a little bit further until they also went off down to Berea to rejoin Paul. But it's wonderful to know that we all have those parts to play. We are all a part of building the church up, of building each other up and helping each other over the mountains of rejection. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the quality of your word. I've said so many times before, it's not necessarily the quality of the preacher, it's the quality of the word of God coming out of the mouths of the preacher. And I ask you, Father, that this word will be blessed into the minds and hearts of those who have listened. In Jesus' precious name. Amen. Lovely. It's been great to minister to you again, and I pray that God will bless you and keep you and shine his face upon you this week in whichever way he can. In Jesus' name. Amen.